Welcome to CSIS Online. The way we bring you events is changing, but we'll still present live analysis and award-winning digital media from our Dracopolis Ideas Lab, all on your time, live or on demand. This is CSIS Online.
Welcome. I'm Pete Daly, CEO and publisher of the U.S. Naval Institute, and on behalf of the Center for Strategic and International Studies and the Naval Institute, we're proud to bring you this continuation of our Maritime Security Dialogue series. This series is made possible through the generous sponsorship of Huntington Ingalls Industries, and our topic today is Congressional Perspectives on the Future of the Navy. And I'm going to turn it over to Congresswoman Luria and Congressman Gallagher in just a moment. But first, a couple of introductions. Congressman Mike Gallagher is a seventh generation Wisconsin native who represents Wisconsin's 8th Congressional District in the U.S. House of Representatives. He joined the Marines right after he graduated from college and served 7 years on active duty as a counterintelligence and human intelligence officer and a regional affairs officer for the Middle East and North Africa, where he deployed twice to Al Anbar province, Iraq, as a commander of intelligence teams. After earning his bachelor's degree at Princeton, he went on to earn two more masters, one from Georgetown in security studies and the second on strategic intelligence from the National Intelligence University. And finally, he earned a PhD in international relations, again from Georgetown. Mike Gallagher currently serves as the co-chair of the Cyberspace Solarium Commission, and he serves on the House Armed Services Committee and on the Transportation and Infrastructure Committees. Representing Virginia's 2nd Congressional District, Representative Elaine Luria served 2 decades in the U.S. Navy. She served as a surface warfare officer on 6 ships deployed to the Middle East and the Western Pacific, culminating her Navy career with command of Assault Craft Unit 2. Representative Luria was one of the first women in the Navy nuclear power program and is among the first women to serve the entirety of her career in combatant ships. Representative Luria is the vice chair of the House Armed Services Committee. She also serves on the House Committee on Veterans Affairs, as well as the House Committee on Homeland Security. Of all the members of the House Democratic Caucus, she served the longest on active duty, having completed 20 years of active military service. She's a graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy and received a master's in engineering management from Old Dominion University. After Representatives Gallagher and Luria make short introductory remarks, we're going to turn things over to Dr. Seth Jones, who's the Senior Vice President, Harold Brown Chair, Director of the International Security Program, and Director of the Transnational Threats Project at CSIS. He will engage today's speakers in a moderated discussion, which include some audience Q&A. Now I turn it over to Representative Luria to speak first. Over to you, Congressman Luria.
Well, thank you, Admiral Daly, and thank you to both CSIS and the U.S. Naval Institute for hosting this event and inviting myself and Representative Mike Gallagher to discuss perspectives from Congress on where we are with today's Navy. And both of us serve together on the Seapower Subcommittee, so these are issues that we are very passionate about, and we actually spend a lot of time discussing amongst ourselves. You know, I'd like to start today by saying that from my perspective that the United States Navy and our nation are truly at a critical inflection point. I think the decisions that we make about the future of our force over the next 4 or so years will either set us on a path to maintain maritime dominance or delegate that role to China. And I really think that we need strong and visionary leadership at the helm of our Navy, and that's critical to maintaining America's position in the world. I think that the Navy must shape its future force towards the core missions that we all know and are familiar with of sea control, presence, power projection, and deterrence. And we also have a very big investment to make in the essential need to modernize our nuclear triad. We face tough decisions ahead in an increasingly resource-constrained environment, and we must first obtain our investment from the platforms and systems that we currently have in our inventory. So I really have been focusing a lot on, you know, getting the most out of the platforms that we have. And I'm sure we'll talk about the Battle Force 2045 and the future, you know, force structure of the Navy. But I think that that is truly a key element. And we also need to make deliberate and calculated decisions about the design of our future fleet. Over the last two decades, our nation's been engaged in two ground wars to defeat global terrorism. And in adapting to this fight, I think that the Navy has, to some degree, lost its focus on its everyday relevance around the world. You know, the Navy's flexible response to both of these wars was necessary. However, while we were engaged in these conflicts, it really allowed China to expand its military and economic influence around the Pacific region. And, you know, according to Reuters, since 2014, China has launched more warships, submarines, support ships, and amphibious vessels than the entire number of ships serving today in the British Navy. So that growth is astronomical and just continues. And, you know, any potential conflict that we have with China is a naval engagement, and we must be ready as a Navy to fight and win in that scenario. So I'll stop there. I think we have a lot of opportunity to talk about these issues through the upcoming question and answer. And I know that Mike is going to give some perspectives as well.
Great. Should I just hop in here? Or hearing no objection, I will give my perspective. Well, thank you, Elaine, and thank you to all of you for hosting this, both CSIS and the U.S. Naval Institute. It's a pleasure to be here with my friend and Armed Services Committee colleague, Elaine Luria. I think it's safe to say that she's the only member of Congress that, during the hearings, knows more about the Navy than the Navy witnesses themselves. And I've seen her wield this superpower skillfully and ruthlessly over the last 2 years, even this morning, in fact, as she advocates on behalf of our men and women in uniform and the fleet she loves. You know, I wish I had better news to share, but I am afraid our Navy will be facing some rough seas ahead. Just last week, we had a troubling report that quoted a senior Air Force official saying that since 2018, the trend in our war games was not just that we were losing, but we're losing faster. If the U.S. military doesn't change course, we're going to lose very fast. RAND's David Akmanek has famously used more colorful language in 2019 to describe what happens to the blue team in China war games. And just last month, Admiral Davidson warned that a Chinese invasion of Taiwan could come not by 2049 or even the next decade, but within the next 6 years. So that should be a very sobering wake-up call for all of us. If public reporting on war game trends is correct, and the Chinese invasion threat really is looming within the next 6 years, where is our sense of urgency? It would be like defense planners reaching a similar conclusion in 1935 and shoulder shrugging the coming crisis. Budgets that roughly stay flat with inflation are not going to cut it. Kicking the can down the road on modernization is not going to cut it. And failing to harden and distribute our military posture in the Indo-Pacific is not going to cut it. So the truth is, you know, we didn't end up in this position overnight. Since the days of the 600-ship Navy, administrations of both parties have kicked the can down the road, particularly when it comes to shipbuilding. During the Reagan buildup, the Navy bought about 17 ships per year. During the two-decade-long procurement holiday that followed in the 90s through the first decade of the new millennium, we averaged less than six per year. And then at the very end of the Obama administration, we had a new force structure assessment from the Navy calling for a battle force of 355 ships, which was a sharp increase from the 2014 plan of 308. But 4 years later, the Trump Pentagon did almost exactly the same thing, releasing Battle Force 2045 in December 2020. Now, I think that is a good plan. I like a lot of what's in Battle Force 25, but the fact remains, by taking 4 years to come up with the shiny new integrated naval force structure assessment, the Trump administration ended up in functionally the same place as its predecessor, which is having laid a solid plan for naval modernization, but then leaving implementation to its successor. So the Biden Navy, which frankly, I hope will be led by Elaine, will have to do a few things. I mean, the first thing is to recognize that we don't have any more time to wait. We can't argue about the perfect future fleet architecture until, you know, Wisconsin dairy cows come home. We need to act with a sense of urgency, given the threat and given the time-consuming process of shipbuilding. And we can't keep this conversation at the academic level. We need to turn it into action. And it's not going to be easy. And I'd like to say we have you know, time to waste, but we absolutely don't. I mean, you know, we may be in what some have called the second interwar period. And if there's anything we've learned from the first, it's that free nations are also free to make the catastrophic decision to underfund investments in their own security. And this time, there's not going to be an arsenal of democracy to bail us out if we make those bad decisions. We are the cavalry. And if we're not ready to go, no one else will be. So, you know, I'm worried that winter is coming. And as advocates for American sea power, we need to up our game. And we need to hold both the Congress and the Department accountable for delivering the fleet we all know this nation needs. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Congressman Gallagher. I wanted to pick up on one of the points and start off with asking Congresswoman Luria the first question, actually two. Just to note, I've participated in some of those war games that you referenced with Dave Ochmanek, and have been involved in some of the broader overmatch work, which definitely is concerning, especially from where the U.S. was against the Chinese 10 to 15 to 20 years ago. The tide has definitely changed in the outcome of those scenarios. But let me go to Congresswoman Luria first, and just to ask, from your perspective, I took note of Admiral Davidson's comment, the commander of Indo-Pacific Command, that China could invade, was prepared to, and might invade Taiwan in the next 6 years. So first, what's your sense about the gravity and the near-term part of that threat? And the second part of that question is, you know, are we there yet with the Tri-Service Maritime Strategy, which I read again this morning, the 30-year shipbuilding plan, Battle Force 2045, is the U.S. appropriately responding to what is increasingly a near-term threat?
Oh, well, thank you for the question. And I'll start out by associating myself with Mike's remarks, because, you know, I think the sense of urgency needs to be there. And when you put it in perspective from Admiral Davidson's comment about the time frame that something like this could happen, I mean, we need to be present in the Pacific. We need to be in the backyard every day. You know, we periodically conduct FON ops, freedom of navigation ops in the Western Pacific. But, you know, the Chinese need to know that we're there and we have the capability to provide a credible threat if they are to take action. And I think we're not acting quickly enough. I spent a lot of time looking through Battle Force 2045, but I think I missed the preface of that, i.e. all of the assumptions, all of the inputs that went into developing that plan. So basically, you know, what was given to us in Congress, and like Mike said, in the last hours of the administration, so we really hadn't had an opportunity to act on that through our cycle, is a menu of like, buy these ships and this number over the next X number of years. But I feel like as lawmakers, there's just so much that we're missing in that discussion. You know, what assumptions were made? You know, assuming that we did our most credible, our most difficult scenario with the Chinese and those operational plans. What assumptions did we make? You know, what are the constraints on building new ships? Why does the plan have us decommissioning so many ships so quickly without a replacement? What are the driving requirements? Is it the number of VLS cells? Is it the number of sorties? Why are we looking at investing in such a wide range of these unmanned vessels that the Navy can't even give us a con ops about how they're going to operate them or kind of what their purpose is? So I feel like on our end, there's a lot of urgency. We want to do more. And I really feel like, you know, the Navy, I think, should do a better job communicating, not just to those of us who are going to, you know, put the pieces together in the National Defense Authorization Act, the defense bill, but to the American public about why this is so essential to our national defense. And another piece as well is, you know, I felt since I've been in Congress and be going through these 30-year shipbuilding plans, if you look over the course of a decade, every new 30-year shipbuilding plan changes in years 1 to 5. It's not a long-term plan. It's not a long-term vision. And if the only long-term plan or vision that we have as lawmakers to say what we need to build for the Navy is, you know, build us 355 ships and 11 aircraft carriers, that's what's in law. But you need to build a Navy to do what? And, you know, Mike referenced sort of the Cold War era and the Reagan administration. You know, Secretary Lehman had a very clear plan of what we needed to build, why, and within a defined budget. And I think that we need that kind of vision and guidance. And, you know, perhaps this even needs to be something so that it can endure that we need to sign into law as a maritime strategy for our country.
Congressman Gallagher, you want to add on to the comments on vision and guidance? Is your view similar that we need a little bit more clarity on the vision and guidance as well?
Yeah, I mean, what I sort of came to realize, I think midway through my first term, as someone who was struggling to sort of understand why we kept kind of all genuflecting at the altar of 355 and in certain NDAAs even enshrining that commitment into law, and yet not really seeing that manifest in reality, is that, you know, it's one thing for Elaine and I to talk to an audience like this, which is mostly specialists, quite frankly, and that's all well and good, and these are important conversations, but perhaps the more important conversation and often overlooked conversation is that which we need to have directly with the American people, making the case for integrated American sea power and why it's a worthy investment. And I'm not sure we've quite connected those dots. And I think, quite frankly, there are limits to our ability to do it as individual members of Congress, or even if the Seapower Subcommittee speaks with one voice. And ultimately, the lesson of Secretary Lehman, I think, is that it's critical for the Secretary of the Navy to be that externally facing apostle for integrated American sea power. And then his or her ability to do that effectively is in turn dependent upon the consistent support of the President of the United States. And that's really what it's going to take to make that case effectively to the American people. And, you know, I come sort of from the policy national security staffer background. So this is as much a criticism of myself as it is of a think tank or any staffer. You know, we tend to throw around these heady terms like, you know, free and open Indo-Pacific, or, you know, global rules-based international order. I'm just not quite sure they're resonating with the American people. We need to find a way to really put this in more concrete and simple terms that connects domestic economic imperatives with the demands of geopolitics. But ultimately, that's an information operation that the Navy and the Navy League and other sea power advocates are all going to have to work on. We just have to make that case for enduring American sea power and make it resonate in bars in Northeast Wisconsin, to put it quite bluntly.
Yeah, and I'll just jump in really quick on what Mike said. You know, when we sent a man to the moon, the whole country was behind that, and they had a vision, and it was important. And I think that our country needs to understand that our naval power and our ability to provide a credible threat to our adversaries and to provide deterrence, it is essential to our American values, in a way that there is a real threat from China, and we need to be able to respond. And I think we really truly haven't been doing enough, and we haven't been communicating the importance of that enough to the American people.
Congresswoman Luria, I wonder if I could just then get you to expand a little bit on your China comment. We talked a little bit about the comments from Admiral Davidson, but can you just lay out briefly, I mean, what's the downside if the Navy is unable to move at the speed with which we're talking about right here, and to take some of the steps that we're talking about, to lay out the vision we've talked about? What's the danger in the Pacific in dealing with the Chinese from your perspective? Because ideally, part of the explanation to the American population is, with the China threat looming large and this issue of competition with China now being repeated by policymakers from both sides of the political aisle, I mean, I think that's one area that may resonate. So where does this leave us with China then?
Well, you know, I think helping people understand, you know, what the threat is, what is China doing, what is their nefarious activity in the South China Sea and the Western Pacific, and, you know, their illegal fisheries, they're claiming, unrecognized territorial waters well beyond their shore, all of which, you know, impact potentially the future of free trade and free commerce. And, you know, the further the Chinese expand afield, both with their economic activities and also with their military. They're building islands, they're arming those islands. Their ships are deploying farther afield. They're having remote bases in Djibouti. They're making huge economic infrastructure investments around the world. So they're basically gaining access to places, creating huge lines of credit for these infrastructure projects that developing countries are never going to be able to pay back. And the fact that the United States, they need to be there. We need to be in those places. We need to be the ones or our allies promoting that type of, you know, economic development and infrastructure in these countries. Because when we lose access, we're not going to get access back where the Chinese have it. So we need to, you know, look at that and understand what a threat that is to the United States. And then, you know, the sense of urgency part, and I've sort of spent a lot of time over my first 2 years in Congress talking about this, but it really kind of crystallized when I was rereading the Battle Force 2045 recently. Because there's really, we have three things that we can do. We need to build more ships more quickly. We need to operate the ships that we have as efficiently as we can. And we need to not divest ourselves of platforms when they still have operational life left. And over time, there have been, you know, a lot of arguments that I think are not well thought out and don't really hold water, you know, such as the one that the rumor that's surfacing again, you can see behind me, the Harry S. Truman, you know, that we would decommission an aircraft carrier after 25 years. I mean, the investment that we make in a carrier, it is not a cost savings to only use it for half of its life. And I think that there are better models by which we could deploy the Navy. We get a lot more presence out of our forward deployed naval forces, FDNF. And if we were able to use that model, either having additional forward deployed locations or just operating along that model that gives us more presence is something that we really should look at. And then just the way the Navy deploys ships. And the Navy came to Congress a few years ago before I was here and, you know, briefed this optimized fleet response plan. So they basically took ships from deploying, we'll just use rough numbers, 6 out of every 24 months to 6 out of every 36 months. So we went from deploying 25% of the time to 17% of the time. And there's some surge built in there, but we can talk about that in more detail later. But, you know, the surge was either not fully funded or surge didn't really create surge like extra capacity. It was just making up for other ships that themselves were delayed in maintenance. But we need to look at, is there a way to increase the effective size of the Navy by using it more efficiently and going back to a potential model that we had previously used or maybe one we haven't thought of before? So, you know, essentially going back to my very first points is we need to build more ships more quickly. We need to use the ships we have more efficiently. And we need to stop divesting of ourselves of ships early when they still have life left for a relatively minor investment to extend their life. Because we need the presence now. We're not looking at what we need 15 to 25 years from now. And so, you know, I think that things like Battle Force 2045 really don't take into account the sense of urgency. And also, like I said, don't provide the context in which the numbers were developed.
Can I add a fourth to your list, Elaine, which I quite like? As
sure.
The Marine in this dynamic duo here, we need a ton of INF non-compliant missiles in the hands of small teams of Marines scattered throughout the first island chain to enable our deterrence by denial posture as well, and do see denial as the Navy Marine Corps team. But I quite like your first three points too.
I want to pick up on one of the issues, Congressman Gallagher, that Congresswoman noted, which is carriers. And I'm wondering from your perspective what you see as the future of the aircraft carriers, and also, you know, what's your sense about the broader debate as well about the midlife overhaul? So what's your sense in general about the future of the carrier?
Well, let me take those sort of out of sequence. I agree with my colleagues' points about the midlife overhaul, and we're not necessarily saving money. And more to the point, I think it's fair to say that when the Navy tried to do this in the Trump administration, let's just say the communication with Congress was suboptimal, and the rollout was suboptimal. Similarly, that sort of the latest efforts to sort of float this idea, I think, have not been that well planned. And then when it comes to just the overall carrier debate. Listen, I love to have a debate about, you know, a lightning carrier, light carrier, this, that's all well and good. I don't think it threatens sort of, you know, legacy programs right now. But really the problem with the carrier is the range of the air wing, right? And we just had a big hearing this morning about unmanned systems, and we asked a few questions about the MQ-25, which is supposed to enable the F-35 to have a longer range. But if you start to look into the actual ranges of the DF-21 missile and its anti-access area denial capabilities against our systems, it doesn't even really make sense or work out. And so I think we really need to focus less on the overall number of carriers over the long term and focus more immediately on the range of the carrier air wing and fixing that problem. But my hope is over time, I mean, you know, obviously, I think we're going to need to get the high-low mix a little bit better, right? I mean, I'm not just saying this because we're making frigates in my district, but my hope is that, smaller ships like a frigate, which can go places that carriers quite frankly can't go, can really be the foundation of the future fleet. And as we figure out some issues with unmanned systems, those can add to capabilities. But I always think you're going to need to have carriers as the backbone of the Navy for the time being. But we can have debates about sort of different different constructs, and certainly we need to have an urgent debate about how we fix the range of the carrier air wing.
Yeah, I wanted to pick up on your point. You mentioned unmanned systems, and Congresswoman Luria, I wondered if you could provide some thoughts on, as we look down the road, there are some R&D technology areas that some in the industry are looking at, you know, prototypes, rail guns, lasers, arsenal ships, drone carriers, high-speed catamarans, stealth ships, some of the unmanned vessels. What's your sense about how important and which ones are to dealing with the problem we've got right now?
Well, I was listening to your list and you just kept going and going and going. So there's a really long list, which makes me feel like there's just not a lot of focus on what the actual priority is. And that I think we should look at it and work backwards. Like, what capability are we trying to achieve? And then which of all of that menu of things that you just listed would actually be the most viable to get there? I think that, you know, I'm not a big fan of just doing technology for technology's sake. I think that some of these capabilities and technologies, you know, can be implemented and be useful in the future. There's just a lot of hurdles to get there. And I think that counting on these unmanned surface vessels, I'll focus on those as sort of the cornerstone of our fleet and countering the Chinese threat. There's just a long way to go. There's the issue of autonomy. There's the issue of reliability of engineering systems to operate like unmanned with no human intervention for long periods of time. There's the communications issue. Even if they can navigate autonomously from point A to point B, their usefulness in a combat scenario requires communication from other sensors and being networked. And ostensibly what would be a GPS denied environment and a conflict with China and other challenges to our communication. You know, there's just a lot of different pieces that need to be worked out. And so kind of taking that back to my discussion of, you know, like, how do we get the fleet we need today, would really take me to the, you know, just to be really specific about it, we don't need to decommission 10 cruisers overnight because those VLS cells are not going to be replaced immediately by autonomous ships. And we have them. We have those ships today. So what is the investment to extend their life for, you know, an additional, say, 10 years? And, you know, I was the XO on a cruiser. You know, I lived through that, the 14-foot crack in the hangar bay and the fact that we couldn't put a helo in the hangar and some of all of the other challenges that we had. And we had had none of the mechanical HME upgrades on the cruiser that I was the XO on. But we have made investments in quite a few of the hulls. And I think if we don't get our money's worth out of those to really just be additive to this problem until down the road, I mean, and there's also the issue with the cruiser for the Air Defense Commander as well. You know, we were counting on those to be replaced by Flight 3 DDGs. We can't decommission all of the current ones we have faster than we can build the new replacements. And that's just one of those areas. So, you know, I am for a continued modest investment in the technology for unmanned vehicles, but at the same time, I just think it's too immature to count on that to really be sort of the cornerstone of what our fleet looks like in the future yet. And the biggest challenge I have is, like, tell me the con ops. You know, what are you planning to do with these vessels? And I've gotten after that in private conversations. I tried to get information about it in the hearing we just had today. And I mean, tell me what it is you're trying to do. Is it ISR? Maybe remotely operated autonomous platforms are good for that. Is it additional VLS cells? You know, do we need to design a really complex system for that? Or can we, say, take an MSC ship today, stick several VLS launchers on there, defend it with another Aegis platform, and get a heck of a lot more VLS cells in there like tomorrow? We could tell, you know, MSC and our engineers to do that. And in a, less than a year, that ship would be on station with all of that capability. But we're kind of putting all our eggs in a basket for something that's incredibly complex for a solution for us. A solution that might not have to be that complex to get the capability we want. So I'll stop there. Sorry, it was kind of long.
No, Congressman Gallagher, I saw you nodding your head a few times. So yeah, I suspect you may want to weigh in on this.
Well, I guess, so I don't disagree. Maybe I'm a little bit more in the mind of let's move fast, break a few things and potentially fail fast when it comes to unmanned systems. But I guess I've not confronted the day-to-day reality of living and working on a ship in the way that Elaine has throughout her career. And to her point, it was just reminding me of a conversation we had this morning in committee where, you know, the Marine Corps was talking about, I mean, obviously this is a ground-based asset, but it was talking about its Rogue Fires program. And it's actually been quite successful in sort of initial development because they took two existing systems, a JLTV and a missile system, and married them together and made it work, right? It wasn't a complex, new, exquisite system that required years of testing and prototyping and development. And so that mindset is one that I quite like. To me, it does seem obvious whether or not you buy into the logic of Battle Force 2049 that over the next two decades, unmanned systems are going to compose a bigger portion of the fleet. I think it opens up a lot of opportunities. I think the question I always come back to is less a technical one that Elaine has focused on, and more of a philosophical one of what is the actual deterrent value of an unmanned system, right? So, for example, the Iranians shut down one of our unmanned aerial systems last year or 2 years ago. I've lost track of time. I think it's fair to say they probably wouldn't have shot down a manned system, right? So are we going to get the same deterrent effect with a large unmanned surface vessel that we'll get with a frigate or a destroyer or a carrier? I doubt it. I just think we haven't done the philosophical work around deterrence that we need to understand what we're doing with these unmanned systems. And deterrence is what it's all about, right? I mean, we are trying to move to a posture of deterrence by denial in the Indo-Pacific. And if these systems don't actually have a deterrent effect, then I think we're going to encounter some problems. So hopefully some of that makes sense, but I just keep coming back to sort of the philosophical issues related to unmanned systems and not as much on the technical side of things.
That's a good point. And that was a very expensive Global Hawk that the Iranians did take down in the Persian Gulf, but it was unmanned and certainly didn't deter them from conducting future actions, including a strike for that matter, against Saudi oil facilities, including Abqaiq.
Where we had a Patriot battery, right?
Where we had a Patriot battery, just not facing north.
That's right.
Facing Yemen. So Congressman Gallagher, I wanted to just raise a slightly different issue. We've talked a little bit about the Chinese, but I wanted to talk a little bit about something else. There are actually two parts of it. I'm curious if you've been concerned about either one of these. One of them is Chinese investment in U.S. defense companies or companies that produce dual use components, including ones involved in naval activity. And how much of this, you know, how much of this concerns you? The second is still the espionage aspect of Chinese activity, because when you look at their weapons, a number of weapons systems the Chinese have developed, they look awfully similar to a number of U.S. Systems as well, in part because they've stolen some of them. So when it comes to some of these issues, how concerned are you, or how concerned do you continue to be?
I'd say highly concerned. I think besides getting out of the – when it comes – if you're interested in U.S.-China competition or the future of our defense posture in Indo-PACOM, besides getting out of the INF treaty, I think what Congress did in terms of reforming CFIUS via a piece of legislation called FIRMA in order to bolster our scrutiny of Chinese investment in American companies in general, but American companies with dual use technology and defense implications in particular, was probably the most important effort we've undertaken over the last 4 years. Now, listen, the jury's still out on that. I mean, we think we came up with a pretty reasonable set of reforms to CFIUS, but we're still trying to evaluate if we gave them the resources they need to be able to scrutinize Chinese capital when it's coming into the United States. You know, we've tried to inject some transparency into financial regulations for Chinese companies listing in American capital markets, sort of in a similar vein. As co-chair of the Cyberspace Solarium Commission, you know, one of our biggest focus was on supply chain security. I'm now co-chair of a task force from the Armed Services Committee on defense critical supply chain vulnerabilities, because I think one of the biggest lessons of the coronavirus pandemic is that our supply chain is very brittle, and in some cases it leads back to Beijing and gives a potential adversary unnecessary leverage over America in the event of war. And certainly the Chinese officials threatening to cut off the export of pharmaceuticals is an example of unnecessary leverage that we don't want to give to a potential adversary. So I remain profoundly concerned about this, but the area where I'm starting to think a little bit more and where I don't think we've done enough thinking is, as much as we started to wake up to Chinese money and interest sort of finding its way into American companies that are part of the defense industrial base, we've had less scrutiny on American capital and money being invested in Chinese companies. Chinese companies that are in many cases defense companies, building things that could be used to kill Americans over the next decade. We've tried to pass legislation to prevent federal government employees and military service member pension money from being invested in such companies. We finally got the FY99 NDAA list of PLA affiliated companies public. But I think there's a lot more thinking that needs to be done in terms of, where do we draw the line in terms of American company capital being invested in Chinese defense companies that are actively trying to destroy us?
Thanks. Congressman Luria, I don't know if you wanted to add on to that. Otherwise, I was going to go in a slightly different direction. So over to you first.
Well, you know, I share the same concerns that Mike outlined. And, you know, I think we talked specifically about investing in U.S. companies or, you know, attempts at espionage and stealing U.S. technology. I think we also need to work with our allies and partners around the world to make sure that, you know, those shared technologies that we develop together that are used mutually for our defense are also protected, and that they're also thinking of and recognizing the Chinese threat. And I mentioned a little bit earlier on, you know, Chinese economic activity in a lot of developing countries is of utmost concern as well. So, I mean, it kind of factors into, like, where is their money going and what influence is it gaining them around the world? I just think it needs to be something that we need to track very closely. And it's kind of an all branches of government type thing. I mean, there's economic, there's diplomatic, there's military aspects to it. So I think it's a whole of government issue that we should definitely track closely.
Great, thanks. Congressman Luria, I wanted to stick with you and actually expand a little bit on your comment. You mentioned allies and partners, and I wanted to stick with that theme a little bit in the Asia-Pacific region in the Indo-PACOM area. And I mean, when you read some of the recent tri-service documents like the Advantage at Sea, it does put an emphasis on allies and partners. The administration has said much the same thing. So I'm wondering, like, for a broad American audience, can you outline, particularly on the naval side, how important the allies and partners are? And then in what areas, when it comes to Navy, and this could be anything from posture to capabilities to, conduct of operations in scenarios like Taiwan, but why are our allies and partners are important, and in what ways?
Well, you know, when I think about our allies and partners, why are they allies and partners? That they share our values. And I think that the, you know, American values and values of, you know, democracy and the freedoms that we enjoy, as well as our, you know, democratic partner nations, whether they be in the Western Pacific or our NATO allies, that's really at odds with, you know, what China has as its values and seeks to spread, you know, around the region and around the world. So I think that sort of unifying piece up front, you know, as to why these are our partners and allies is very important. You know, I think that we could talk about, you know, very technical capabilities that we should be able to leverage. We can also talk about, you know, geography And, you know, I've been encouraged by seeing sort of a wider spread of our geographic partners operating in the Western Pacific. Some of our NATO allies have been frequently operating there more recently. And then the Quad type of exercises that have happened that have included India, Australia, Japan, and the U.S., I think are very important. And, you know, this is a thing that we've revisited, you know, each year since I've been on the Armed Services Committee. It's, you know, the UN Convention of Law of the Sea, and the fact that, you know, we are disputing Chinese unrecognized maritime claims, but the U.S. and very few other nations in the world, we find ourselves with very few other countries that are not party to that. So I think that that's a discussion legislatively that we should continue to look at in order to better, you know, defend against what we consider to be unrecognized maritime claims. So, you know, I think there's important capabilities that we've developed through sharing of technology with such as our Japanese allies. You know, they have a destroyer that's based off of, you know, the Arleigh Burke class destroyer that they operate. I think continuing to conduct exercises where we refine and improve our ability to communicate with, share data with, share intelligence with these allies who are our partners, who share our values and want to, you know, prohibit increased, you know, Chinese expansion in the region. And we also need to take that to, you know, not just the larger countries that have significant militaries or navies. We need to really look at what smaller partner nations we can engage with. And the fact that the Coast Guard has recently started deployments to the Western Pacific to enforce fisheries issues and some of the other things and be in that area where the Chinese are frequently operating, where they're frequently harassing our allies. And like Mike said, you know, with smaller platforms, I mean, the new frigate we're building, I personally consider it like a 2/3 size DDG. I think we can actually build that and also need to focus on some smaller platforms similar to the National Security Cutter, and whether that's operated by the Coast Guard and the Navy or, you know, and or some mix of it. I just think that we need to have more presence on that scale in the Western Pacific with our allies. So certainly not a comprehensive answer. Could probably talk for quite a while and some more thoughts I have about this, but I can turn it over to Mike to also address it.
Well, I mean, I agree with just the importance of the Quad, and I'll give the administration an attaboy for meeting with the Quad before this meeting with Chinese officials in Alaska. I thought that was the right move, and it sends a signal that America is going to prioritize our allies and work with our allies, and in cases defend them against Chinese economic coercion. And the administration made statements warning the Chinese about further economic coercion of Australia, for example. So that's an area where I salute them. And I think, you know, there was a lot of bipartisan support in Congress. To me, it starts and ends with the map, right? And I don't just mean that in an abstract sense about Spikeman versus Mackinder and the importance of the Eurasian Rimland. But I mean, these are massive distances we're talking about in Indo-PACOM, and we can't commute to work, right? We're just not going to be able to commute to work if things really heat up, and so we're going to be relying upon allies and partners to be forward deployed and have that day-to-day presence in the region. And I mentioned you know, INF non-compliant missiles and teams of Marines moving around the region. Well, that depends in turn upon basing agreements with our allies, and particularly as we consider how we incentivize the onshoring or nearshoring of American manufacturing so that our supply chains are more robust and we're not dependent on China for key manufacturing. Certainly, we can't make everything in America, and we don't want to descend into pure autarky. So we're going to have to figure out how we work with our friends and partners to collaborate. Particularly when it comes to critical technology. One thing I'm incredibly intrigued by and I intend to work a lot on in this Congress is this concept of the National Technological Industrial Base, which is an official thing we've created in law, and Canada's part of it. The Aussies are part of it. The UK is part of it. But all it is sort of it's a rhetorical commitment right now. There's a lot more we can do to bring that to life and actually collaborate with our allies when it comes to critical technology that's going to be decisive. That's going to determine whether we win this competition over the long term.
Great. Thanks for your pretty comprehensive answer. I don't think I've heard in one of these sessions anybody comment on Mackinder recently. So kudos to that.
I'm a Spikeman man, not a Mackinder man.
All right. Okay. I wanted Congressman Gallagher to touch on a couple of other things. We've got a lot of questions from the audience, so I'm going to read one of them. And I think the first one is directed at you, although I suspect Congresswoman Luria will have, based on her district, will have some answers and comments along these lines as well. But Congressman Gallagher, to you first. I'll read the question. Several members of Congress have expressed concern about China's manufacturing capacity. What specifically should the U.S., this is regarding naval activity, what should the U.S. Be able to manufacture and not just outsource or manufacture more efficiently and effectively than it does at present? So I think this gets to broader production capabilities in the U.S.
Well, one thing that comes to mind, from the perspective of China manufacturing and U.S. naval interest is dry docks, right? We need dry docks to repair big old Navy ships, and we have some of them on the West Coast and the East Coast, but they tend to be built in China, and then they get chopped up into three pieces and shipped back over the Pacific, and then you know it takes a long time to get approval from local officials to be able to reassemble them. I mean, the whole thing's a mess. And so that strikes me as something we should be able to build in the United States. As we've had these discussions early on in the task force, I think there tends to be broad consensus around the need to invest money and have some form of industrial policy when it comes to microelectronics, semiconductors, chips. And the fact is, one of the reasons why she has designs on Taiwan is because of TSMC. And if he takes over Taiwan, he can hold the rest of the world hostage because they'll have control of or dominant position when it comes to semiconductor manufacturing. So that's one area. When we were in Australia recently, all we heard about was rare earth minerals and the fact that we need to partner both on extraction and processing of rare earth minerals. And then beyond that, I would say energetics and things that we need for conventional munitions to go are an area where we need to be investing some money to have domestic manufacturing and not be dependent on China or any other foreign power for that matter.
Congresswoman Luria, you want to add to that?
Yes, well, I agree with the specific things that Mike brought up. I also think that sort of my biggest concern relative to China and their ability to build a fleet and build it at the scale they can build it at, it's not necessarily capability as much as it is capacity. You know, our maritime industrial base, you know, has shrunk as our Navy's demand for building ships has shrunk. And, you know, we want to basically turn the key and say, like, build us this much bigger Navy, but is the workforce out there? Are the industrial facilities out there and able to do that at the speed and at the scale that we would desire to even get to the 355 ship Navy, you know, that we have in law today, or, you know, a much larger Navy in the future? So, you know, I think that one of my biggest concerns is those investments that I think we failed to make in that sort of infrastructure that includes our public shipyards. And we have a plan in place for a 20-year improvement plan for our public shipyards, but I think it's much too slow. You know, Mike is talking about dry docks for, I'll call them smaller ships, but they're small compared to a carrier, right? And so if you look at the dry docks we're using at our public shipyards, like Norfolk Naval Shipyard on the East Coast, I mean, they date back to post-World War I. And that kind of infrastructure and that optimization of our repair processes has not really kept up with technology, with some of the changes, you know, like climate change and sea level rise is real. It floods all the time in Hampton Roads. And so, you know, we need to make these investments to be able to continue to maintain the fleet that we have. So I really think that, you know, kind of taking a step back and looking at what our capacity is to build our ships and maintain our ships is a really key element to this, you know, idea of like what is our eventual or potential future conflict with China or another adversary. So I really think that investments there are very important and are, you know, often overlooked.
So staying with, and we just have a few minutes left, but another question, Congressman or Congresswoman Luria, from one of the questioners is, it gets into a gray zone. And so the question for you is, how should the U.S. think about naval competition in the gray zone? Not just China, you know, the IRGC has a naval component as well. We've already raised the Iranians a little bit. But if you look at the Chinese, you know, they build islands from reefs in the South China Sea. They've conducted a range of disinformation campaigns. They obviously use their Coast Guard, their People's Armed Forces Maritime Militia. They've used fishing boats to patrol areas. So how do you, when you look at competition, I mean, there clearly is a focus, as there should be, on conventional scenarios, but where do you put in kind of activities operating in the gray zone?
Well, you know, I think we need to focus on those a lot more. And some of the things that Mike brought up, you know, specific to the Marine Corps and the ability to have, you know, Marine Corps smaller units operating in a distributed way throughout, you know, the AOR, I think is very important in that. Some things I brought up with the Coast Guard. The Coast Guard has unique law enforcement capabilities and, you know, just got some information in our hearing we had with Admiral Davidson recently about, you know, how successful the U.S. Coast Guard National Security Cutter deployment was to the Western Pacific, and how that can, you know, sort of build, not in a military way, but in a law enforcement, fisheries enforcement way, to, you know, stopping some of the Chinese malign activity, or just being there, like being there with our presence. You know, I spoke to the defense minister from New Zealand at a meeting a year and a half ago, and, you know, the main part of the discussion is, like, we just need the Americans here, like the American, you know, the American, the British, you know, any NATO forces, you know, anyone who shares our values, who can be here in places where the Chinese are all the time applying economic pressure on these small countries, that, you know, sometimes it's hard for them to fend off. But if we're better friends and we're there, you know, saving their fisheries and stopping the Chinese from harassing them, you know, I think it does need to kind of be more of a whole of government approach, and using things like the Coast Guard and, you know, other levers within other departments in our government. So think if you were sitting around the country team briefing at an embassy, kind of all of the folks who were there, the DEA, the Department of Agriculture, like Commerce, there's elements in like all of those things that really shouldn't be stovepipe, but I think should be looked at more holistically, of like how we can put them all together to, you know, deal with this issue and all these issues in the gray area that are, you know, well below the threshold for actual combat, but they need to be continuously and persistently pursued to, you know, maintain our influence and presence in the region.
Great, thanks. And we only have a few minutes left. So Congressman Gallagher, over to you. One of the individuals that has written in asked the following question: will investment and deployment of advanced weaponry such as rail guns and directed energy systems be enough to counter China's anti-access area denial missiles and capabilities in the South China Sea?
Well, and, you know, I think about it less in terms of any one sort of weapon or system being enough to counter their A2ID posture, and more us, maybe I can connect this to the previous question. I think us sort of flipping the anti-access area denial approach against them, right? Which is as much a mindset as it is a function of any individual weapon system, right? I think getting creative with how we forward position our forces, with how we operate on a day-to-day basis, as Elaine rightfully points out, just that day-to-day presence, getting comfortable operating in the gray zone, more comfortable operating in the weird Mos Eisley cantina that is sort of our allies and partners in the region. I mean, taking a page out of our own history to do this, even if we, you know, tend to do black and white a little bit better than gray. I mean, we operate by decentralized command. We operate according to commander's intent. And theoretically, that should favor us on a day-to-day deterrence by denial fight with the PLA Navy, right? I mean, how could I describe this? I mean, think about the old classic John Wayne movie, They Were Expendable, right? About PT boats that punched above their weight against the Imperial Japanese Navy, launching torpedoes and speeding out of harm's way. Now imagine if those same boats had anti-ship missiles that could have targeted Japanese surface combatants from hundreds of nautical miles. Like, we can get creative and do that with Mark 6 patrol boats armed with LRASMs today. So I think it's more of a mindset shift than it is a function of rail guns or this technology or that technology.
Great, thanks. And Congresswoman Luria, I think that the last question over to you, unless Congressman Gallagher wants to add anything to it, is a question from someone that's getting to the administration's current posture review right now. You know, there is some deliberation about decreasing the posture, particularly in the Middle East, and shifting it, continuing to shift it over into the Indo-PACOM area. And the person writing the question has raised this issue about, you know, the Russians have a base in Tartus. They're active in the Mediterranean now. Chinese are building and continuing to build infrastructure in places like Djibouti. How do we think more broadly about global posture versus continuing to focus predominantly on the Indo-PACOM area? So as the administration is weighing what to do on posture, I mean, what are your thoughts on how to think about this, particularly from a naval perspective?
Well, you know, there's some things I think are not just really clearly delineated in our maritime strategy. I mean, I think that, you know, are we a Navy that wants presence? Do we want to be do we want to be everywhere all the time? Or do we want surge capability in a time of crisis or aggression? Or do we want a combination of both? And, you know, where does that balance fit in? And I think that gets back to, you know, this ongoing discussion about how many ships do we need? How many aircraft carriers do we need? And really, like, what are our priorities for that presence? You know, for a very long time, we had one or even more carriers in the Gulf full time. We backed away from that. But some of the recent, you know, malign activity from Iran that was, you know, referenced already here today has gotten us, you know, essentially full time of the carrier in the Gulf again. And so I think that we have to, you know, look at, like, what are the requirements that we have? Is it fighting in one theater? Is it multiple theaters? Is it fighting and holding in another theater? And really determining, like, what it's going to take to be able to accomplish that. So, and then, you know, there's the presence, there's the surge, and then there's the support, like everything else that goes into that, the maintaining of our ships, the manning, the training, and with the resources that we have available, how do we get the most out of each of those elements? And I think that, you know, if we take a step back and really have to prioritize, like, where do we want to be in the world? Why do we want to be there? What risk are we willing to take? And, you know, what is the purpose of our having presence in those particular areas of the world and with what frequency? So I think all of those things should go into this analysis. And I think there's going to be, you know, a lot of tough questions to make and a lot of assumptions that go into that. You know, if we need a bigger Navy, how quickly can we build it? What's the capacity of our industrial base? What are our limitations of our current weapon systems versus future things that we need to, you know, do R&D to develop? And I think those are a lot of tough questions. But I'll kind of circle back to where I was at the very beginning, was that I really don't feel like we've had any sort of consistent long-term maritime strategy to guide us through this. And every year, it just keeps changing. And that's, you know, pretty hard when the Navy and the other services are coming to Congress and asking us for those resources for programs we're going to invest in today that are going to be around for decades. Yet every year it's something different, or there's not really clear vision as to why they're asking for those particular things. So, you know, I'm a big advocate of, you know, having this discussion and really codifying a long-term maritime strategy so that we can make those right investments for our national defense in the future.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'll just add a quick point. I mean, at the level of grand strategy, if we all agree that Indo-PACOM is the priority and CENTCOM is not the priority it once was, in my opinion, it then does not make sense to grow the end strength of the Army, right? Because we're talking about a largely a Navy and an Air Force effort in the priority theater. So point one. And then point two, the only way in my mind to responsibly reduce our presence in CENTCOM without creating anarchy is to, and this gets back to your earlier question, Seth, is to work closely with the allies and partners we have on the ground in that theater, some of whom drive us crazy, none of whom are perfect, but that is how we have an economy of force effort in CENTCOM. That's how we play Moneyball in the Middle East. It's working by, with, and through local allies on the ground, as Seth, you've written about quite eloquently when it comes to that region.
Well, great. Great responses to both of you, and just on behalf of the U.S. Naval Institute and the Center for Strategic and International Studies and support from Huntington Ingalls Industries, I want to thank both of you for phenomenal comments. I mean, we covered everything from strategy down to aircraft carriers and everything in between. So really appreciate your time and effort. Really appreciate your expertise in these areas. And thanks again for joining us today.
Yes, well, thank you for having us, and we'll look forward to continuing the conversation in the future.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you.